This week, the decision makers. With the future of the Kansas City, Missouri School District now in the hands of Missouri lawmakers, we push aside our regular reporters to bring you the key lawmakers who will ultimately decide the district's future. Plus, around the table with us will be the Missouri lawmaker who this week introduces a measure requiring schools to verify the immigration status of their students. We track the new state proposal to teach intelligent design next to evolution in the classroom. And we weigh up the governor's State of the State address and a new push to make I-70 a toll road as you travel from Kansas City to St. Louis. I'm Nick Haynes, and thanks for joining us on the program that goes beyond the soundbite and takes you behind the headlines making news in Kansas City. While we're normally joined by the people who write the stories you read about or you see on TV each weeknight, this half hour we have with us the people who are quoted in all of those big stories. Senator Victor Callahan is the Senate Minority Leader in Missouri. He is a Democrat from Independence. Myron Neth is a Republican House member from Liberty. He is the lawmaker who actually introduced Mayor James's plan for a takeover of the Kansas City, Missouri School District. Also with us is Senator Jolie Justus, a Kansas City, Missouri Democrat, and Republican Senator Will Kraus of Lee's Summit, who's the man who introduced the bill this week requiring that schools check the immigration status of their students. We'll discuss that later. But first, one of the big headlines locally this week is that barely anyone is running in the upcoming Kansas City, Missouri School Board elections, and uncertainty over the district's future is considered the main reason. Even school board president Eric Leonard West is not running again. More than 1,500 anxious parents have asked to transfer their children to surrounding districts, but are still being told no, even though state law allows them to go to adjoining school districts. That is now subject to a court case that won't be heard again until next month. Meanwhile, Kansas City Mayor Sly James continues to head to Jefferson City to ask for passage of a bill that would dissolve the elected school board and allow for mayoral control of the district. That, we're told, is still being held up by state lawmakers. Myron Neth, you're the one who actually introduced the bill. What is the holdup?
Well, I think that there's just not a lot of consensus on anything. I think everybody's kind of holding out and just seeing what else is out there. I mean, there's Senator Callahan's plan. There's other plans that are still being worked on. I mean, I'm working on other plans right now because I think what we're trying to do is get the conversation started and saying there needs to be a change. I think the community is saying there needs to be some type of drastic change. What that looks like, we're not sure. We've taken the mayor's plan. Other cities have done that. It's been successful in some, not successful in others. We think there's validity to it, but a lot of it's just getting an idea out there on the table to say, let's discuss this seriously and talk about the future governance of the district.
Before we hear about Victor Callahan's plan, you actually represent Kansas City. So what is the holdup, do you think, then, Senator Justus?
I think Representative Neth hit it on the head. I mean, the reality is that we're all sitting back and making sure that the best plan possible is put forward. And so I'm just still in a fact-finding stage myself.
But we have 17,000 school students here not really knowing what's happening.
Absolutely, and that's something that we need to address, and that's why we're having discussions on an ongoing basis, and I think we're getting somewhere.
The mayor was on this program about 2 weeks ago making a very compelling case, as some of you has told us, for wanting to take over the school district, saying that this is the best hope that the district has for moving forward. Why don't you agree with that, Senator Callahan?
Well, the problem is I would like to say that I think that the mayor deserves a lot of credit for showing concern for the school children. I think that's his motive, but this idea is a bad one. No one in this community would be talking about this, quite frankly, if Mark Funkhauser was mayor. And I think when you change the law, you transcend the career and popularity of one, you know, current mayor. Also, we have to have a very realistic understanding that it's not as though the Kansas City School District is going to become provisionally accredited. This unaccredited status is going to take 5 to 7 years to get out of. And again, that transcends that. The other thing, with all due respect to Mayor James, he has a city to run. My belief is if he wants to run the schools, the appropriate thing to do is go to the voters of Kansas City and ask whether they want that to happen. And so I think for those reasons, I also believe that he would be conflicted. There are 14 school districts in the city of Kansas City. In the Turner case, which you talked about, which involved the right of students from an unaccredited district, you have a Hickman Mills taxpayer who lives in Kansas City, Missouri, You have a center school district taxpayer who lives in Kansas City, Missouri, and a Kansas City school district taxpayer. In court, they have contrary interests. The mayor's running the school district. Which taxpayer of Kansas City, Missouri does he represent?
Okay. You've exposed some of the problems. What is your plan then, Senator Callahan?
In 2007, if you think about it, Nick, one of the problems in the Kansas City School District, in my view, is we've had an endless discussion of governance. I think we have to bring some structural change. And the best way to do that is, in the last four decades, the only decision the taxpayers and voters of that district have been allowed to make is who is on their school board, except for once in 2007, when they allowed 40,000 people from Western Independence and Sugar Creek to join another district. Both districts approved it. The voters voted for change. That was a structural change. I want, in all of this process, with Representative Neth, with Senator Kraus and Senator Justus, to empower people to start making decisions about what they want their district to be.
Okay. What does this bill actually do, though? Isn't it about allowing other school districts surrounding the Kansas City, Missouri School District to annex portions of the Kansas City, Missouri School District?
Well, but, Nick, there's a protection in that, just like we went through in Independence, it has to come from both places, and it has to be approved by both districts. And I think that makes sense because taxpayers should be allowed to make those choices. In 2007, the people of Independence School District and the people of the Kansas City School District chose to change.
Okay. But Senator Kraus, you represent Lee Summit, which is one of those school districts surrounding the Kansas City, Missouri School District. Do they have any interest whatsoever in taking over or being part of any of the Kansas City, Missouri School District schools?
Well, underneath Senator Callahan's plan, Lee Summit would not be one of the collar school districts that would be part of taking over part of Kansas City if they chose to annex in. It would be Independence, Center, Raytown and North Kansas City. So Lee Summit wouldn't be part of that. I will tell you that I've talked to some superintendents that were collar districts that their interest in is educating those students in their home communities. And that's what's good about Senator Callahan's plan is that it wouldn't be busing kids out of the inner city to the suburban school districts. And let's be honest, parents need to be involved. And if the school that the student's going to is so far away, they're gonna be less involved. We need to try to look at solving the problem in their current area instead of busting them out into the suburban areas.
Okay. But there's no consensus on any of these bills, though. Is that correct?
Well, I would say that.
No consensus on the mayor's plan. No. There's no consensus on what Senator Callahan's talking about.
There's no consensus, but I think there's one bottom line here, I think, though, is the fact that whether we legislatively allow Senator Callahan's plan to go or there's a difference in governance, whatever, either now or in 2 years, the current board will cease to exist one way or the other. I mean, we can either legislate it out of existence right now or annex it out of existence or wait 2 years where there's a two-year wait period here under the unaccreditation with the state board. And the state board, I don't think, will keep the existing board in place.
Senator Kraus.
You know, what's really good is in Kansas City, we have multiple solutions. On the other side of the state, there is no solutions coming out. So what's good is the fact that we are engaged as a community looking at what's best for the Kansas City School District and those kids in the school districts.
Senator Callahan.
I think it's very important in this process, as Representative Neth alluded to. Keep in mind, there is one thing we really need to do, and I have mostly suburban districts, as does Senator Kraus. We've got to have in place a protection for taxpayers. We have to fix the Turner decision some way that makes it fair and equitable. That's one thing, regardless of what happens as far as the Kansas City School District itself. We've got to allow taxpayers in suburban districts and those school districts to have in law a protection that defines how these school transfers would take place. Because absent that, the potential for educational chaos, not only to the Kansas City School District, but at the same moment to all the suburban and surrounding districts, even Lee Summit, I believe would be a horrific prospect.
At the end of our week in review show, our year in review show, at the end of December of 2011, we asked the reporters that were around the table, would the Kansas City, Missouri Elected School Board exist in 2012? And the consensus was it would not. Do you believe that, Senator Justus?
You know, I don't know if it will or not, but we have to proceed as if it will be. And so I was saddened to see few people coming out and running for office. I think the current school board should move forward as if they're going to be in existence and not wait for the legislature, because I think this is going to be a hot issue that may lead to a lot of gridlock.
Representative Neth?
I would say no. I mean, I just have a gut feeling. I mean, I think that there's going to be enough with all the legislation, because there's going to be some kind of big bill put together with something. And I think there's going to be something put into place to replace it. I mean, or the two-year window taken away.
How about the mayor's plan for taking over the schools, Senator Kraus? Is that some of the reporters around this table told us that that was a dead issue?
I think that I commend the mayor for coming to the table with a plan. I believe that there is more consensus around Senator Callahan's plan because it gets buy-in from the other school districts, and it gives immediate accreditation to those areas and gives somebody that knows how to run schools the ability to go in and overhaul those schools.
Okay. Well, last week on the program, we dissected Kansas Governor Sam Brownback's State of the State address. This week, it was Missouri Governor Jay Nixon in the limelight as he delivered his annual State of the State address before a joint session of the legislature in Jefferson City.
Since taking office, I've cut government spending by $1.6 billion. And with the balanced budget I present tonight, I'll have reduced the government's payroll by 4,100 positions. The state workforce is the smallest it's been in 15 years.
Reading through most of the newspaper headlines across the state, though, it seemed that the biggest loser in the governor's speech this week was higher education. $106 million in new cuts proposed. Each university asked to find another 12% from their school's budgets to eliminate.
I'm calling on our colleges and universities to continue to look for more ways to cut overhead and administrative costs and run smarter, more efficient operations.
And by the way, you can see the governor's State of the State address again on Saturday at 1 p.m. here on KCPT. With so many areas of government, though, that can be cut, why is it that higher education became the big target then, Senator Justus?
Unfortunately, it is a low-hanging fruit. The reality is that no legislator wants to cut K through 12 education. No legislator wants to cut things like durable medical goods. And when you look at folks like the University of Missouri who have a $1 billion endowment, it's hard not to do that. The problem with this, Nick, though, is the problem is that during the good years, we starve higher education. And so it makes it increasingly difficult during the lean years for the universities to be able to take that impact. So it's incredibly frustrating to see these cuts. Even though they do seem to be low-hanging fruit for legislators.
And this is supposed to be helping, though, during a bad economy that universities and that is supposed to be helping with economic growth, though, Victor Callahan.
Well, I agree with that. I mean, Nick, this is my ninth year in the legislature. Every year I've been there, there has been a budgetary meteor headed. And I don't mean to diminish the problem, but we always miraculously, working through the process, try to find solutions. All this is this is the first step of the governor's presented his budget. The legislature, if we have different ideas that can avoid those cuts to higher education, we should pursue those.
Now, this was the headline that we were seeing around the state in different news articles that I was reading. But if you were writing the headline on the governor's State of the State address, what would you have been writing, Senator Kraus?
I don't think it was a balanced budget that he proposed. I think what happened was is he's relying on programs to pass legislation that didn't pass last year and it didn't pass in special session to balance the budget. So I think the highlight would have been unbalanced budget. Governor proposes an unbalanced budget.
I wasn't seeing that headline when I have LexisNexis, so I can see all the newspapers. I didn't see that one. Representative Neth.
I kind of say the same thing. I kept on hearing all the stuff, and I'm like, I know there was the higher ed cut, but then I was like, where's kind of the rest of it? I know some loss of jobs and things like that, but some of those have already been cut. I mean, that was a little misnomer, a little bit, in my opinion. The budget thing is so complicated, and quite frankly, I'm not the big one on the numbers on the budget. I'll be honest there. I mean, I leave that some of the experts kind of thing, but it's the higher ed thing. You know, we've made cuts in that, and then the governor withheld some over the last year as well. I mean, it's one of those things where it is getting a little frustrating to keep on going to them as far as the cuts, and you wonder, you know, is there something else? But, you know, there's very little other places to cut.
What about jobs? Isn't that supposed to be the big issue that we are supposed to be working on in both states, Kansas and Missouri? You had a special session of the Missouri legislature that didn't actually achieve any of that. Are we moving forward with anything relating to jobs, Senator Justus?
Well, the good news is you have a united Kansas City delegation who is moving forward on jobs creation. And we stand strong together, and we're trying to push it forward. The reality is that we have a majority party right now that disagrees on what government's role should be in jobs. job creation, and that's where the holdup is. And until we get that ironed out as a legislature, we're not going to be able to get substantive jobs bills through.
That's you two, because you're part of that majority party.
Well, Senator Justus is right. There is a divide in the Missouri House and Senate on what to do with tax credits. There are a number of senators on my side of the aisle, Republicans, that believe we need to reform tax credits. And I agree with them, and here's why. This projected for 2013's year, $675 million to tax credits. If you compare that to what our higher ed appropriation is going to be this year, is $700 million. Our tax credits are reaching what we're appropriating for higher education. So I think we need to do some reforms there, and that's kind of caused some problems because one of the ways we incentivize job creation is through tax credits. So until we reform some big tax credits, there's going to be a continued headbutting, if you will, and I think it's largely between the House and the Senate.
Senator Callahan.
Nick, we met in special session for the China Hub, which was this concept for the St. Louis airport. But here in Kansas City area, we should be proud that the Ford Motor Company is making a $1.3 billion investment in Claycomo. They will retain the 3,600 jobs and add 1,700 more. In Wentzville, on the eastern side of the state, GM is making a $350 million investment. I mean, think about those 1,700 new jobs. Think about the 1.2 million man hours it will be in construction to build that plant. Think about the people who make upholstery and glass for automobiles and all the parts and all those other jobs beyond those assembly line jobs. So while we're disappointed that disagreement hasn't brought a broad stroke, we've certainly had success in this area of bringing a critical thing for the Kansas City economy.
And there's also been a lot of criticism. Of course, it seems that the Missouri legislature seems to be very focused on the jobs that are going to Kansas when those companies leave for the Kansas side of the state line. But the state legislature hasn't done a whole bunch about trying to compete with the Kansas side on economic development incentives.
You know, Nick, Senator Kraus and I actually worked together last year on some job retention language that was part of a larger economic development package that we were able to get out of the Senate. And unfortunately, because of that debate between the Senate and the House, the overall bill was not able to get passed. I'm looking forward to continuing to work with Senator Kraus and others on getting that passed. And I think once we see something move through, you will see something related to job retention in that package.
Okay. Well, Missouri could be the next battleground in a nationwide fight over tougher immigration laws, according to the Kansas City Star. A Missouri Senate committee began hearings this week on a bill to require schools to check the immigration status of students, and it calls on police to check anyone they stop if they have a suspicion they could be an illegal immigrant. The bill's sponsor is State Senator Will Kraus, a Lee Summit Republican. Oh, and he happens to be around the table. Senator Kraus, what motivated you then to introduce this measure?
Last year I had a bill that would have required the Attorney General to sue the federal government for restitution. And unfortunately, it got held up in the Senate. And when we were asked to provide data on the impact of immigrants in the state of Missouri, illegal immigrants in the state of Missouri, and we went to the different departments to try to get that data, and no one was keeping that data. So this bill is in an effort to try to get quantifiable cost to education to educate people that are here illegally. The bill is very clear not to use this list for deportation. It's solely for us to get the data to be able to take, and then I have another bill this year again to require the Attorney General of the state of Missouri to sue the federal government for their failure to enforce immigration law in the state of Missouri.
And the bill then comes before the full Senate, and Senator Justus votes how?
I'm going to vote no on the bill,
Nick. And why?
The reality is, Nick, that I think it is the federal government's responsibility to enforce immigration laws and to set immigration policy. This bill, unfortunately, to me, is another unfunded mandate for our schools. They're already strapped for cash. We clearly have our own issues in Kansas City with accreditation. We don't need to be taking time doing head counts on who's here legally and who's not here legally. The reality is that we have other issues we need to focus on, and I know it's hard to talk about money issues, and it's hard to talk about tax credit reform, and it's hard to talk about economic development, but that's what we should be focusing on. We should not be focusing on these continual cultural wars.
Well, you're also in that Senate, and it's coming to you, and you have to vote on that too, Senator Callahan. And how do you vote?
I would have to really probably consult with really how the schools, because I guess the problem conceptually I have is that I'm not sure the schools would be equipped. I mean, we can have a discussion about whether it's good policy or not, but just sort of a mechanical point would be, it seems to me that you're at some level turning schools into immigration officials. And I believe that states have certain responsibilities in immigration. Clearly, the federal government has failed by both parties in the last decade to address this, and that has put the states in this position. But I think before we get to turning the local school superintendent into an immigration official, and I don't want to misstate his bill, but those are the concerns I would have just at the outset.
Question?
I would say that we already do residency checks. Every year when you go and enroll your student in the school, you bring documentation that you live in the district. All I'm saying is bring your birth certificate so you can prove you're a citizen of the United States.
Okay, and it even got to the House. The General Assembly is also voting on this, and you vote how, Representative Neth?
It will pass the House if it gets to the House. I mean, just the makeup
of
the
House. But
how
about
right you? I would probably vote for it. And the reason for, I mean, there's a practicality, and I think that these type of issues get blown way out of proportion. Just like the senator said, is that I think we count everything else. I mean, we're required by the federal government and by the state, you know, the schools, whatever, to count everything. My wife's a teacher. I mean, all the paperwork they have to go through to account for things. And to say that, oh, well, we don't want to count that one. Because, I mean, look, we're just looking for a fiscal impact. That's it.
Are you concerned, though, what Senator Justus was saying about this being an unfunded mandate, though? The schools have already got lots of paperwork. This will just be more paperwork for the schools to
be involved in. Trust me, we already have so many unfunded mandates in the schools that if we want to start talking about that and getting rid of some more of those, I'm fine with that.
Okay. An issue that for a long time has been big in Kansas politics is now playing out on the Missouri side of state line, and that's evolution. A Missouri state representative wants intelligent design taught in public schools alongside evolution. Rick Bratton, a Republican from Harrisonville, says most Americans believe in a higher power, and yet students are taught that we arose from primordial ooze. Representative Bratton believes students should learn about both theories and then decide for themselves. This was a lively topic of conversation on Thursday night's Ruckus program.
Evolutionary origin science is highly controversial among evolutionists.
Creationism and intelligent design is completely based on faith, and evolution is based on science.
Just the whipsaw nature of this is ridiculous, and we're wasting too much time on an insignificant matter.
All right, this has come up in the state of Kansas and Missouri before. How is this particular bill being received in the legislature? Now, you're on the Education Committee in the House.
Yeah, and I'm assuming it would come through. I don't know. I don't know if it'll see the light of day. I mean, I'll just
because anybody can propose, anybody can introduce
legislation. You can introduce anything.
Yes.
I think it's one of those things that kind of comes back of what are our priorities. And quite frankly, that's not on my list of priorities for the year. Is there some validity to some of the arguments? Maybe. I'm okay with that. It's one of those things, quite frankly, given everything else we have to deal with, I don't want to mess with it.
Ah, but because it was discussed on the Ruckus program, does it elevate it in your consciousness, Senator Callahan?
I didn't know Ruckus was still on. I agree with some of the comments that were made, which is this is a matter of faith, you know, at a certain level. I mean, and faith should be separate from some government action. That's been the foundation of this country. So that's why I think it's an incredibly bad idea to start having the government dictate now what Judeo-Christian belief is. That's for churches and individuals to decide as a matter of faith.
Senator Justus.
I have 17,000 kids right now who are in limbo in my school district, and this is not something we should be talking about. The creationism argument is over. It's not science. We teach science in Missouri.
Senator Kraus.
I teach my kids at my home about intelligent design. They are created from God. This bill is in the House. I don't believe it ever gets to the Senate. And if it does get to the Senate, I don't believe we'll ever get it passed.
Okay. The head of the Missouri Department of Transportation paints a grim picture of the future of Interstate 70, the state's busiest highway this week. In less than 20 years, I-70 is going to be a gravel parking lot, he tells a joint legislative transportation committee this week. And the option of doing nothing is not there. MoDOT wants legislators to grant it permission to enter into a public-private partnership that would turn I-70 into a toll road from Kansas City to St. Louis. The cost of rehabbing and expanding I-70 across the state has been estimated at $3.5 billion to $4 billion. They have toll roads in Kansas. Why not in Missouri?
I don't really think it's a good idea, because one of the problems with the plan...
There's no other options. We've just heard this.
No, Nick, there's other options. I mean, look, the problem with the current plan is this just fixes I-70. There is a much bigger problem in transportation in Missouri that we have facing, and we need to grapple with that problem. This... people will be under the misimpression.
So you wouldn't support
people
the toll roads?
People will be under the misimpression that we somehow have fixed the highways by having toll roads. Okay. And all we're doing is fixing one highway. And I think taxpayers need to understand what the needs are, evaluate those, evaluate the positives and negatives of pursuing that.
I'm on a narrow time frame here, but you wouldn't support toll roads on I-70?
Not at this point without a comprehensive
Senator
approach.
Justice?
I'd like to see the people of Missouri vote on it.
Okay, there's a public vote.
I'd be a public vote.
A public vote? Mm-hmm. You'd support that?
This
Senator
plan
Kraus.
Is through a public-private partnership, consequently of going around the people, because right now our state constitution does not allow for toll roads. I would say the voters have to get a chance to vote on this before I
would support. So you would support, though, a public vote on it?
I would support allowing the voters in the state of Missouri to vote on whether they want a toll road.
Okay, that is our Week in Review. Our thanks to our news reviewers, Missouri State Senators Jolie Justus of Kansas City and Victor Callahan of Independence, Liberty Republican House Member Myron Neth, and Lee Summit Republican Senator Will Kraus. I'm Nick Haynes. From all of us at KCPT, thanks for spending part of your weekend with us.